I'm being told we can. So, hello to everybody. Welcome again to the folks who were here with us in our performance space in Bethany Arts Community here in Ossining, New York, and to those on Zoom and to those watching live streaming on Facebook, thank you for coming out and joining us. So, for everyone who has not heard my spiel too many times, this is the last in this group of our multidisciplinary artists' public programs associated with their residency here at Bethany. So we have artists with us who include the dancemakers you're about to see tonight, as well as the composer and double bass player you just heard, and playwrights and visual artists and a host of different mediums that we've had people working with us with us this past 2 weeks, I guess, that we have. For those who don't know, Bethany Arts Community was founded on the belief that the arts and bringing together people of all disciplines, along with people at all levels of their career, with the local community is a wonderful way of enhancing our perceptions and perspectives of the world. And I think actually tonight's performances and the other ones earlier this week are a wonderful example of how we do that. These performances, as well as the residency programs, are made possible by the National Endowment for the Arts, the New York State Council on the Arts, and Arts Westchester, as well as generous support of those in our community. Tonight we're going to see ReWritten, which is a work in progress showing with artists in residence Matthew Cumbie, Tom Truss, and their partner Diane Samuels, who is not able to join us tonight, but is, I think, represented in some way.
She may be on Zoom.
She may be on Zoom. So dancemakers Tom Truss and Matthew Cumbie for ReWritten shares aspects of their performance and their community engagement project. ReWritten uses the often silenced intimate relationship between Herman, Melville, and Nathaniel Hawthorne as a portal to reflect on friendship, writing, social mores, and notions of queerness. As part of the evening, you'll be invited to share your ideas and feedback through a facilitated conversation to help inform and further shape the development of this work. Matthew is a collaborative dance maker and an artist educator living in Washington, D.C., although I think at the moment living in Maine.
A little bit of both.
Yes, at my old stomping grounds, Colby College.
Colby College.
His work has been supported by the National Endowment for the Arts, the D.C. Commission for the Arts and Humanities, the Arcus Foundation, and the Somerville Arts Council. Originally from Houston, as we said, he's now a visiting assistant professor at Colby College in Maine. And Tom Truss is a community-based artist, educator, and performer. He's performed and shown his work at the Kennedy and Lincoln Centers, the Joyce on the Boards, Jacob's Pillow Dance Festival, Roundhouse Theater, and the New Zealand Fringe, to name just a few, as well as in Rivers, Used Furniture Stores, Fire Escapes, and he currently co-hosts Ask Your Gay Uncle, an advice podcast with his gay nephew, and is devising a dance theater puppet solo show called Behind the Tapestry. And with that, I turn it over to Matthew and Tom.
Hey everyone, I am Matthew, or Matt, or Maddie. There's lots of variations on my name, so you get to choose your challenge.
I'm Tom.
And no variation.
If you're my family, you can call me Tommy. Some of you are my family.
Well, and on the notes of family, we just want to thank everybody here at Bethany Arts Community for the incredible support and generosity that they've shown this week, opening their doors and welcoming us in to continue working on this project. It's meant so much. So much thanks to Abby and Bonnie and David and Keith and Sherry and anybody else that's helped make this place what it is. I also want to extend so much gratitude to the artist cohort that has been here working alongside us this week. I can't tell you how rich these conversations we've had at the cafeteria tables have been, how rich these artistic experiences we've had together. I know that my work has been deeply changed and informed by each of you, so I want to thank you for your companionship and camaraderie. We, also on the notes of camaraderie, Abby already said this, but we are missing one of our collaborators tonight, Diane Samuels, who may be joining us in the Zoom world. So if you are here, thanks, Diane, for joining us. Diane's this incredible visual artist who works with paper and often works in response to texts, which feels like a really interesting theme throughout the night. Somewhere I want to chat more with you later. But we found Diane actually because of a work that she made in response to one of Herman Melville's books, Moby Dick. And it was this huge installation, and she kind of...
10 feet wide, 47 feet long.
And she transcribes the entire book onto, micro-transcribes the entire book onto small pieces of paper that she treats and then arranges in really interesting ways. So we were really excited to figure out how to continue working with her through this residency, even though she couldn't be here in person, which some of the what we were sharing pre-show, those sleeves were kind of part of her design, and then she's helping us really think through some of the textual archival components of this work, which we'll say more about in a little bit. I also want to acknowledge that we have an incredible team of artists that are working with us on this project that are not here this week. And I just want to kind of call them into the room really quickly. Roma Flowers, who's this amazing projection designer in Fort Worth. Rudy Ramirez, who is a director and theater artist in Western Massachusetts. Larry Burke, a filmmaker in Western Massachusetts. Jeremy Winchester, a lighting designer and set designer in Western Massachusetts. Catherine Stubbs, an incredible queer scholar and dramaturg for this project in Maine. And Jake Blount, who is our composer and a banjo player and fiddle player who's composing music for this work. He's out of Providence, Rhode Island at the moment. Did I miss anybody?
I don't think so.
It's a whole big family.
We just saw them all this afternoon doing a feedback session from a performance that we just did at Arrowhead. Arrowhead is the home of Herman Melville, and it's about 20 minutes from where I live, which is in Great Barrington, Massachusetts, and his home is in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, which is in the Berkshires. And he lived there for 13 years, and what's his name? Nathaniel Hawthorne showed up, and they met on a hiking party of literary scholars and publicists on a mountain about 5 miles from where they both lived. And that is the first that they met, and there was an instant spark, and they stayed connected until Hawthorne left 15 months later. It was probably some of their most productive time. Moby Dick was written then, House of Seven Gables was written then, and they influenced each other greatly. And some might say that they influenced each other in a romantic way as well. There are letters between Herman Melville to Nathaniel Hawthorne that exist, 12, and all the ones from Hawthorne to Herman Melville have been destroyed or lost. And so we have a one-sided story.
Yeah. Some things to know about tonight's performance. So this is a work in progress, even though we've been working on this for 2 years. What you're going to see tonight are a series of sections that we've kind of Frankensteined together to test out some new stuff, bring back some old stuff, see how they're in conversation with one another. These are not the costumes we're wearing. This is not the music you're going to be hearing on the show.
There is no projection.
This is not the set. Like, what are you getting, really?
These are the dancers.
And yeah, like Abby said, afterwards we would love to have a conversation around what you're taking away, what connections you're making. We've got some questions, and we hope you've got some questions too. So with that...
I think I just want to say that what you're seeing, there might be information missing. Mm-hmm. What you're seeing is like one section and then maybe another, and not maybe, and another section. And it's an evening-length work, about an hour and 30-ish minutes, and you're going to get about 40 minutes, some of which is new material for us, thank you, people here, and then some of it is material that we've collected that we started 2 years ago that didn't make it into the site-specific performance. It was at Arrowhead, so it's a lot of new stuff.
Yeah.
We're excited.
And with new stuff, we want to, at this point, invite one of our dear friends up on stage to join us. Tochuku, could you join us? Let's give him a round of applause. Thank you. All right.
Well,
Everybody's a writer, everybody's a dancer. That's my belief. Dear Herman, it's me. We haven't met yet, officially, but I've been reading your work and about your life lately. Moby Dick, Billy Budd, Bartleby, and of course, your letters to Nathaniel. I'm writing today because I'm about to have an adventure. I know you had lots of those, and I need help. This adventure that I'm going on, it's big. We're talking a show and a move and moving, traveling across hundreds of miles and completely revisioning my life. And those are just the things I know now. Really, when you think about it though, when do we ever know? Anyways, it's the transitions, the in-betweenness that I'm wondering about. You know what it's like to pick up and move your entire life in the pursuit of things that may take life worth living. And you know what it's like to feel loss. Even in the face of debt and without any recognition for what you've done, you continued. You found a way. How do you navigate? How do you keep one foot in one place and reach as far as you can with the other? What do you do when you feel the pull of the tide and you know that it's going to come crashing right back? How do you keep your head up? How do you surface for air? Pardon the metaphor, but you're good at treading water. When a swell comes, you resurface. As I think about what's ahead, I'm uncertain. I want to know that I'll be okay. I want to know that there will be a way through. I want to know that I have what I need to do this. In Moby Dick, you used so many words to talk about how to tie rope, or how to identify a whale, or for the many uses of spermaceti. So tell me, how do I keep going without knowing what's next?
Nathaniel. We're kind of similar. A lot of your dreams didn't happen. You moved a bunch and you cared.
While you can. then. Your heart beating my ribs and mine and yours and both. And God's. A sense of unspeakable security is in me on account of your having understood the book. I've written a wicked book. And I feel spotless as the lamb. Ineffable socialities are in me. By what right do you drink from my flagon of life? Lo, when I put it to my lips, they're yours, not mine. I feel that the Godhead is broken like the bread at the supper, and we are the pieces. Hence this infinite fraternity of feeling. Lord, when shall we be done? As long as we have anything left to do, we have done nothing.
Lord, when shall we be done changing?
Ah, it's a long stage with no end in sight.
The night coming and the body cold, but with you for a passenger, I'm content. Shall leave the world with more satisfaction of having come to know you. Knowing you persuades me more than the Bible of our immortality. What a pity your plain bluff letter should get such gibberish. Mention me to Mrs. Hawthorne and to the children. Bye to you with my blessing. Herman.
P.S. I can't stop yet. If the world were made up entirely of Aegeans, I'll tell you what I should do. I should establish a paper mill, one into the house, and so have an endless ribbon of fool's cap rolling in upon my desk. Upon that endless ribbon of fool's cap, I should write a thousand, a million, a billion thoughts, all under the form of a letter to you. The divine magnet is on you. Mine responds. Which is the biggest you have?
There's a prompt. You gotta reach like you're wiping yourself. Sorry, I just thought of that. Back to front, back to front, front to back. Sorry, I had to say it. Yeah, and there should be a pen there, and there should be some paper. And so you have about 5 or 6 minutes in which to do this. And if you don't have one, I've got extra.
Hey, friends out in Zoomland, this is Matthew, and I just wanted to take a moment and share with you what's happening here in the studio so that you can also participate. We've invited the audience members here in studio to take a few minutes to respond in writing to a prompt that they've been given. And so I'd like to invite you in this moment to also take some time and respond to a prompt. You can do this on your own in the living space wherever you are. You can also choose to drop this in the chat. There's so many fun ways to participate. Thank you, technology. But for those out in Zoom, I'd like to invite you to, I'm going to recall the prompt at this moment. Thank you, Kate. Yeah. And this is actually the prompt I was hoping to get. So for those out in Zoom, I'd like to invite you to write about a time when you needed to make your own story, to see yourself in it. I'll repeat that again. Take a few minutes, and if you'd like to participate and join us, write about a time when you needed to make your own story, to see yourself in it. We'll be back in just a few. Thank you.
I usually write in the kitchen.
Actually, that's not true. I write everywhere.
I write in my living room, I write out on my deck, I write down by the river, I write in dance studios and coffee shops, actually not since COVID. In college, I used to write in the library at a carol. It was just my carol. It was great because I could leave my books there and my papers, little tchotchkes, I decorated it. I loved it because it was quiet. I have an office right next to my kitchen, but I never write there. I always write in the kitchen at the counter because it faces a window that looks out onto the Housatonic River. Actually, my desk in the office also faces a window, but that one faces my neighbor's parking lot. I write, I don't think I'm looking out a window. I'm actually looking at what I'm writing. I used to write a lot. I wonder if I had a dedicated writing place. I write more often and it would be better. I always wrote in journals. Now, I write in my laptop. It's a little bit awkward and slightly uncomfortable and dissatisfying. But that's because I'm sitting on my high chair, which is in front of the kitchen counter, and there are all these cords there, like my laptop charger, my Bose speaker, my insulin pump charger, my continuous glucose meter, my all of them. And to the left is a spice cabinet my father built. To the right, a basket that's filled with odds and ends, like pens, highlighters, a box of sparklers, Post-its, a razor blade, a roll of tape that doesn't have a dispenser, which drives me nuts because I'm always trying to find the beginning of the tape, a condom, actually two condoms, and a chewed up cord to my headphones, which I never use, and some random paper clips, and a pile of programs from concerts where I have circled various titles because I know someday I am going to choreograph to every single one of them. Behind me is a butcher block. Behind that is my stove, refrigerator quietly humming. Little bits of food are on the floor. They wouldn't have been there, but I had to put my dog down a couple of months ago. I used to do a lot of free writing. That was in my journals. I don't do that anymore because my hand cramps when I'm holding a pen for a long time. I'm a pretty good typer, though. I'd be better if I didn't look at my hands. I don't know if I could put my hands on those journals now. I suppose I've lost that freedom. Now I'm goal-oriented. Edit and type. Edit and type. Edit and type. Edit and type.
My desk faces a window on the north side of our house, looking out at Mount Greylock in the distance. With snow on the ground, it appears a white whale breaching the surf. My room seems a ship's cabin. When I wake at night to the shrieking wind, I almost fancy there's too much sail in the house and I'd better get to the roof and rig in the chimney. My books find their home on the bookshelf to my right. My harpoon above that. When needed, it becomes a poker that I thrust into the flames to stoke the fire. My meals are brought to my door. I take them at a table by my fire. My desk is for my paper and quill. His bed is to my left. for those nights when Hawthorne comes to visit and it's too late to go home. In this room, none shall bother if we do not permit it. My desk is where I do my writing, reviews, letters, the whale. My study is the biggest room in our house, and yet, why couldn't you say yes?
I feel like saying that question is tired and unoriginal. There, I said it.
Why couldn't you say yes?
Yes is too hard. Yes means everything is going to change. Yes means the line that has been drawn is now sometimes it's easier to say no.
Then why did you say no?
I said no because no has been said to me and to everyone over and over since time began. No defines space. Nothing there. Something here. No means ending. No means don't begin. I said no.
What did you want to say?
I wanted to say, I'm going to miss you. I wanted to say, I'm not strong enough to do this. I wanted to say, what the fuck are you thinking? I wanted to say, right there. That's where we belong. Of course, I wanted to say, I think this can happen. Of course, I wanted to say, I am in love with you. You. And every part of you ignites every part of me. And when I spend the night in the bedroom that is next to your writing studio, I am home.
Tell me what you want.
I want nature. I want words. I want to hear God. I want to understand you. I want to fall and land on both feet. Tell me why you wanted me to say yes.
When I'm with you, I'm not at a loss for words. I know that what we make can be a blueprint for how we live, and I need you to do that. When I'm with you, I'm at my best.
Why can't you be your best by yourself?
These boxes that we are made to live in do not suit me. And we need to leave society to find ourselves, to chart a path, find a way. This shows me that that is possible.
What have you been unable to say yes to?
What have I been able to say yes to? I've been unable to say yes to this. I've been unable to say yes. This. But what I want to say yes to is not knowing.
Why can't you say yes?
I thought I already had. I guess it is on still. Great. Hey, friends. So I think I'm just going to grab my notebook, and you've got the questions.
Okay, great.
And yeah, so if this is the part where you want to kind of quietly sneak away, this is great. It's a great opportunity for that. If you want to participate in the conversation, we would love to get some of your thoughts and reflections in response to what we've shared tonight. And so, yeah, we're just gonna gather some things. And Tochuku, thank you so much. Can we give Tochuku one more round of applause? So I just wanna be really transparent in this moment first and just do a quick time check. Great, we have about 10 minutes. So this, but we are certainly open to conversations outside of this.
Yeah,
absolutely. And I want to, you know, working on something for 2 years, you have lots of opportunities to get feedback. So we are not new to this. I do want to just say that one of the ways that we found really useful in getting feedback is through a particular methodology that is really near and dear to us, Liz Lerman's critical response process. We're not going to do that tonight per se, but there are a couple of kind of tenets that we find really helpful. And so first and foremost, we just want to know what was interesting, meaningful, memorable, what stood out, what struck you, what resonated, what excited you, what surprised you, what delighted you. Any reflection within that realm is something we'd love to hear and collect and gather. Beyond that, we have some questions that we'd like to ask And then on the other side of all that, we certainly would love to hear what questions are coming up for you. But I'll just kind of, again, ask, what was interesting, meaningful, memorable? What stood out? What struck you? And let's just dive in. Nikki, hey, friend.
The two authors, and then how I felt like it was two timelines. So the past during their letter writing, and also your story and the description of where you write. That was, it was like I was seeing you float in between these two realms, and it was really beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I agree. The intimacy, it already felt really intimate when we were exploring the relationship between the two authors. But then, yeah, once there was like this personal bit that came in, all of a sudden it was just like, it felt, yeah, like all I can say is the intimacy was just like cranked up to 10, like I could not stop crying for some reason.
Kate and then Molly and then Michael.
Two things. I was really moved by what I felt was the wrestling between a sort of perceived idea of what masculine should be, and some of the movements seem to really describe a prescribed masculinity versus a softer, curious masculinity. And there was a moment where I had a light bulb go on where I was like, I'm not sure that, I actually felt as like, oh, he's not just talking to Hawthorne, he's talking to himself.
Molly.
I really like the part when you were talking about your writing space, and there's just the kind of moment talking about all the chords, remember who's sticky's arm. It just made it seem like dance and movement is part of whatever artistic practice you're doing, kind of part of your everyday life as well.
Michael.
Yeah, two things that kind of connected to what other folks have been saying. There, not only the intimacy of when you described your space, but there was something, the beauty for me, and I can't explain it exactly, but shifting from that into, I guess, kind of the imagined writing space.
Mike, can you grab the mic so that folks on Zoom can hear you?
Oh, yeah. So the transition between the intimacy of your description of your writing space and bringing us into the presence of your life to the imaginary writing space, and I can imagine more of that in the piece, the shifting back and forth between, because there's something about, like, the greater resonance and depth of what the material and what that those the imagined life of those characters are in relation to your own lives. Like, I love that. And then also, I really love the passage about, and so it was so odd for me because of what I was writing, making up the prompt about the defining yes and no, and the depth of that. There's just so much there that I found really beautiful, and it's spatial, and it's about power, but it's, for me, it's also about, the nose can be about withdrawing, it can be about harm, and it can be about safety. I don't know, there's just so much in
there.
Thanks.
Summer. I almost called you Sonia, but I didn't.
I mean, I think, I don't know if this is kind of basic to mention, but even the movements themselves really resonated with me. I think earlier in the performance, like, there was a part where Matt was mirroring a lot of Tom's movements, and he was kind of doing it like from a distance, and I kind of resonate with that feeling of like, I mean, that feeling of like longing, but from afar, and then just kind of like going wherever they go, that really struck a chord with me.
Great. We're going to do two more and then go to another question. Maggie, since you're right there, Abby, thanks.
I liked the, I know this isn't the music that you guys are going to use, but the music that pops up in the very beginning, that kind of jovial, you know, intense, it really like I don't know if this was on purpose, but you're, that music was great, and then the piece continues. You lead us right to this precipice where it felt really intense when you launched us into the writing prompt. Mm. And I usually hate interactive, like, when people are like, and now it's your turn to project, I'm always like, I'd rather not. And I was like, I'm just like, no, I won't be doing that. But when you were like all of a sudden, it was so effective. I wanted to write, I needed to write. And then when you reintroduced that like music that we had heard in the beginning, it was like subconsciously informed me that this was also just like a rush of energy. And I thought that was really effective that music was mirrored in these both these moments. It really took me. It took me there.
Mm. Excellent. All happenstance.
Mm-hmm. I was.
Wait for the mic.
I was just struck by. She prefers when it's held. I do. I was just struck by how much of this was just about yearning. Mm. The entire thing felt like it was. It like. An intimate yearning and also a grander yearning. And I went, and you talked, I can't remember who talked about the intimacy of it, but the intimacy continued even if you were across from each other, even when you were far away from each other, and that's where the yearning came in.
We've got, if there's things that didn't get said, we're hanging out afterwards and come grab us and just plowing us through some very specific questions we want answers to. So, what did you think of the moment leading up to when we almost kissed and how we repeated it? And did you want us to kiss? Did you want that moment? What was that like? That's a new thing that we've tried out.
I was really interested in how you feel.
I was interested in how you feel about this gesture in that moment.
How I feel about his gesture.
I'm about this gesture specifically. I'm wondering how you, Tom, feel about this gesture, because I felt like this heart-beating gesture was like Matt's home-based gesture. And for a while, I thought your gesture was like the suspender gesture. And like whenever it was getting too much, you were like, masculinity suspenders. Yes. And you were, you know what I mean? So it, I, in that moment, I was more like, what's up with, what does he, do you like this? Is it hurtful? Yeah, is it painful? Do you want to do it, but you can't?
Yeah. Mm. Great. Thanks. Okay.
Oh, yeah. So that was actually the moment where I was like, oh, they're not two different people. They're one feeling and another feeling. Mm. In my mind, I was like, that was, and I don't want you to kiss. Not because I wouldn't love to see that, but because I think it's too clear, for one thing. I think it's too clear of a gesture, and I think it's like so sensual, it's almost not sensual.
Yeah.
And also I think it's, if that moment of acceptance is going to come, I think it has to come much later.
I'm gonna have us go on to the next question and tell me later. Okay, thank you. What were your thoughts and experience of having our scribe up here? One of our thinkings is that when we tour this, that we will ask people to write, and we're not quite sure how to do that. And if we're going to ask people who are local poets, or people who are local playwrights, or authors, or people whose voices aren't normally heard, or people who we haven't figured that out yet. So, just curious, what you think of having someone who never spoke up here?
And I know that that was also commented on in the chat on Facebook or Zoom, whichever platform you might be Zooming in or tuning in from. So we've got that in the archive as well.
The thing that I was really struck with was, my God, that pen did not come up off of the page. No. So I was fascinated about what was going on the stage. And then also, in my head, I was like, he's directly the conduit for what he's being shown. And it was like this, it transformative for me. Mm-hmm. It was like we were literally seeing the embodiment of your work on a page.
And please, folks who may not be a part of the artist in residence, it'd be lovely to hear what you have to say as well. So jump in at any point. Yeah, and don't feel like you have to either. Yeah. Yeah, Michael.
I loved Jacob's presence on the stage, but I actually was like, oh God, he's going to stand up and read it, right? I think really, really wanted that. and also on that note, as you were sharing a little earlier, I was like, oh yeah, there's something about, and when Maggie was sharing about us writing, and then the whole piece is a conversation of people writing letters to each other. It makes so much sense to me that that was part of the piece and that could even grow somehow. I don't know how, but I love that.
I'm going to take us on to our next question and perhaps the last one, but maybe not.
Well, I just want to say, like, I think in direct relation to this, I know I kind of checked in with David at some point midway through this, and somebody commented about the role of the scribe and wondered if that was Ishmael, right? Ishmael writing Moby Dick? Yeah. Uh-huh. Really interesting. I just wanted to say that.
Yeah. Everybody had there were maybe five or six prompts that people had, so you did not all have the same one. And I'm wondering if your prompt took you further into the piece or if it took you out of the piece. And if you want to, you know, and you can just let us know what your prompt is if you're like, oh yeah, it took me out or whatever. Yeah. Molly.
My prompt was, when was a time that you've destroyed something? Mm-hmm. And I kind of figured, since, you know, I hadn't heard about the wonderful, you know, gay marriage of these two authors, that this was ultimately destroyed. Mm-hmm. But I feel like at the beginning I thought that maybe, you know, they had a long friendship, or that this was something that was kind of quietly unsaid, and with that prompt I'm like, oh, this is going to end really, really, really badly. So I don't mind spoilers, but it seemed to clue me into the ending.
Interesting.
Yes.
My prompt was, when was the time did you walk away? And I was really surprised. It took me directly to a time when I was in a room and there was a connection with someone across the room. And that person offered a way for us to connect in the future, and I walked away. So it took me back in, yeah.
Thank you.
One thing that we're planning on doing is, when we go on tour, we're going to go into residencies and have community engagements where we ask people to write. Yeah. And one of the thoughts is that they will be writing on these sort of map quilt things that will be folded up and put under the chair so that the audience will then open it up and could have a chance to read them and add to them. And then those will get collected and sewn together and will be a part of the set that things are projected on. And then that will be a standalone piece that Diane Samuels, and I highly recommend that you check her out. Her work is extraordinarily beautiful.
DianeSamuels.net.
.net, yeah, yeah.
And Diane has been on. She is on Zoom.
Oh, hey, Diane!
Last one, and maybe really quick.
I think we should move on just because of time.
Yeah.
We can ask that. Yeah, we can move on.
Okay,
we can ask that later.
What's missing? What would make you feel more invested in this story? And I know that you didn't like get the full story, and there's probably another 40 minutes of stuff.
I'm interested in if there's any other conflict beside the one where you guys are just like nervous to be gay. Like,
was the other conflict that happened between them?
Yeah, uh-huh. I'm interested. It's just like, yeah, I'm interested that, I mean, I'm with Amy. The sense of yearning in the piece is in itself just so gripping and overwhelming.
Yeah.
I'm interested.
You know, they did not meet very often because Hawthorne lived in a very small house and could not have servants to look after his three kids. And Melville didn't have enough money to have a servant.
And so they had to like arrange for their people or whoever to just look after the kids so that they could go off.
Yeah.
So you like there's a conflict. I think that's really interesting. Yeah.
I'd like to see some additional conflicts and just some like we do see a lot of in this one specifically we see a lot of you know, Melville coming for Hawthorne and the pulling away and blah, but when do they, the moments when you were like laying back in his lap mm-hmm. and like, I would love to see those sweet moments, those gripping moments where they know something's, I want to know why they're both so conflicted.
Yeah.
The good moments, the moments that you are undeniably a spark where no one is pushing or pulling, you're both like there, you're present, you're with each other. Like we want to see like, why is there such a conflict here?
Yeah. Right, great.
Take it away, Michael.
Actually, I think I would love more of the time slippage of mm-hmm. your personal presence. Mm-hmm. I was reflecting a little bit as Maggie was speaking on when you just were describing your writing space. In a sense, it was not emotionally neutral, but it wasn't like as if you were talking about something, an emotional story, and yet it implied solitude, mm-hmm. and then that was kind of intriguing, like what about your romantic life, you know, like there's something about like why tell this story, mm-hmm. and we're hearing more about you both, because then we didn't really hear about your life, mm-hmm. like why does it resonate, and somehow even without saying, you know, being literal and saying why, it brought me into some sort of sense feeling of connection mm-hmm. that I loved, mm-hmm. so I would love more of that.
Any last thoughts?
The intricacies of male relationships.
Mm. One more time?
The intricacies of male relationships. Mm. I also didn't want to kiss because I didn't want to know if you guys were really in love or not, or if you were just like so close, and just watching you form the relationship was so like tender and lovely.
So can we ask the scribe how it felt?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
And what's the novel coming out of it?
How did you feel when Tom approached me this morning to ask if I could do this, I felt that perhaps I would be a distraction from the main show. But being up there also, yeah, I think someone mentioned I seem to be a conduit, and I felt really immersed in the whole sort of performance, and not just seeing their performance, I was also immersed with how the audience responded to the performance. And so I tried to capture what was going on, and if you read through what I wrote, I tried to capture what was going on between Tom and Matthew, as well as how the audience is perceiving their performance, mm-hmm. and sort of the sights and sounds, and what is carried in the silence, in the brief silence that sort of happens during the performance, and just the sort of, would I say, minute moments that people would probably like glaze over, I try to, you know, magnify them in my writing. Mm.
It was so great to have you up there and to hear the writing.
Oh, so
you know, that was so fantastic. Like, that to me is a real keeper.
Yeah.
I just want to say one thing about the scribe position. What we're thinking of is having this paper, which is gompy paper and then glued onto silk. So it's quite strong. And we're thinking of the scroll being, you know, maybe 100 feet long, and that it comes out and like arcs through the space. And so whoever's like writing on it, they're just adding on to this endless scroll of words.
Yep. Yeah. In the back.
Okay.
Abby's running for you.
Okay. What was your inspiration for getting together and doing this?
I had directed Frankenstein, and it was beautiful words, and I was directing some actors who I didn't think were doing a great job, and I was like, I want to do some beautiful words and do a one-man show. And so I started looking at short stories had some friends who were quite big in the Edith Wharton world, and they kept giving me short stories and I didn't find any I liked. And then one of them said, well, you should look at the letters between Herman Melville and Nathaniel Hawthorne. Some people thought they were lovers. And I had never heard that. And I'm like, well, wait, I'm a 58-year-old gay man and I've never heard that. Yeah. How can that be? And then I am at my home and I'm like on Scruff, which is a dating app for guys and a hookup site. And I'm like, oh, this guy's cute. And I look and it's Matthew and he says he's a dancer from DC. And I'm like, I dance in DC and I know you're up here dancing at Jacob's Fellow Dance Festival. So I'm like, beep, 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 beep. And he writes back, he goes, Tom Truss? And it turned out we danced in the same company. And so then I invited him over for drinks on my deck by the river. And in there, it was just like, yeah. Oh, you need to do this with him. And it's not a one-person show. It's a two-person show. Mm-hmm. And I asked him, and we did not know each other at all. And he was like, yeah, I like words.
Well, and to add to that, I think, so for me, about 10 years ago, I had a moment where I realized I didn't know anything about the histories that have shaped my body and my community as a queer man. Growing up in Texas, that's not something you're often taught. And so I felt moved to start making work about queerness and queer history specifically, or queer histories. And so much of that I wanted to really do through storytelling and intergenerational conversation and collaboration. And so I've been doing that work for some time. And when Tommy invited me over and shared the story of these two men, they are 15 years?
17 years, like almost the same age as us apart.
Yeah, there's a real kind of correlation between our age difference and their age difference. And like Tommy, when I was told that like there was this potential relationship somewhat romantic between them, my jaw dropped and I was like, what would that have done for like little queer Maddie in Texas had I known that this like these authors that I'm made to read were also a part of potentially a community that I'm a part of? So yeah, it was an immediate like, hell yeah, let's do that.
Thanks everybody for showing up.